हेलो एवरीवन, दिस इज नलिनी फ्रॉम महारानी साइंस कॉलेज फॉर वुमेन बेंगलुरु. इन दिस सेशन लेट अस सी अबाउट द केमिकल कंपोजिशन ऑफ द एंजाइम्स व्हिच इज यूजी पेपर 8 प्लांट फिजियोलॉजी 3. इन द लास्ट सेशन वी डिस्कस्ड अबाउट द नॉमेनक्लेचर एंड क्लासिफिकेशन ऑफ एंजाइम. टुडे लेट अस सी द केमिकल कंपोजिशन ऑफ एंजाइम्स. The nature, chemical nature of the enzymes is mainly all the enzymes, they belong to globular protein kind. And here, the like all other proteins, they are also of three-dimensional in nature. And all the proteins which are usually tertiary or quaternary when they are functional, in the same way, these enzymes will be present in the tertiary structure. They also contain all the 20 amino acids as do other proteins. Sequence of proteins is specific in their specific enzymatic tertiary protein structure. Loss of tertiary structure renders the enzyme very much inactive. So this tertiary structure is very much important for the enzymes to be active. Let us see how exactly the amino acids are piled up in the polypeptide chain. You can see the amino acids which are seen as the chain of amino acids making the polypeptide. This will be the primary structure of the amino acid. And next one, the pleated sheet and also alpha helical structure. Those two structures can be taken as the secondary protein structures. They occur when the sequence of amino acids are linked by hydrogen bonds. And very much important functional protein structure in case of enzymes that occurs when certain attractions are present between alpha helixes and also the pleated sheets. So there'll be either disulfide or dihydrogen bonds which are going to help in the formation of known globular tertiary structure, which is very much important for the functional enzymatic proteins. We can take an example here, the example of enzyme ribonuclease. Different folds of polypeptide chains are held together here by 4 disulfide linkages or disulfide bonds to give a particular compact shape to the enzymatic protein. If these linkages are reduced by the reducing agent like mercaptor ethanol, then we can see the compact three-dimensional tertiary structure of the protein will be depleted, and we can see unfolding of the protein structure making only disulfide bonds. If we take up the reverse of this process, we can again get back the normal conformation of the protein with the reoxidation in presence of air. So this is an example how exactly only in the tertiary three-dimensional structures the enzymatic proteins act. Let us move on to the next one. Based on their ability to act on substrates, the enzymes can be divided into two major types, that is simple enzymes and conjugated enzymes. Simple enzymes are those enzymes where the apo enzyme part or the only the protein part is going to involve in the catalytic activity. If there is conjugated enzymes, then we can see the apo enzyme group is taking the assistance of non-protein part, that is called as the prosthetic group. Okay, simple enzymes, very good examples are pepsin, trypsin and almost all the digestive enzymes. Conjugated enzymes, enzymes which act only in presence of the non-protein part, but at the same time non-protein part alone cannot take up the catalytic function. Okay. Here, the protein part, you can see here, the protein part can be called as the Apo enzyme. Non-protein part is the cofactor. And it is of two types again. Organic substance, if it is acting as the cofactor, then we call it as coenzyme. And if the organic substance which is not tightly bound, then we call it as coenzyme. If the organic substance is tightly bound to the apoenzyme, then we call it as the prosthetic group. Other cofactors may also be present, that is inorganic metallic ions. They are simply called as activators. So cofactor can be organic substance or inorganic substance. If that organic substance is not tightly bound to the apoenzyme, that is it can be easily detached from the apoenzyme, then we call it as coenzyme. If it is tightly bound, the organic cofactor is tightly bound, then we call it as the prosthetic group. Cannot be separated easily. It can be inorganic copper, zinc, manganese and also molybdenum. Organic ones will be the flavomononucleotide and also flavin adenine dinucleotide, heme protein and also the iron porphyrin, biotin are the other examples for the prosthetic group. Let us see how exactly the active site plays a very important role in the catalytic activity of the enzyme. Here the active site of the enzyme where the prosthetic group is going to make the enzyme very much inactive. If we, in the absence of the non-protein part, the enzyme activity is completely stopped. The active site is the region of the enzyme where substrate binds. This active site, formation of this active site itself in conjugated enzymes will be made. The active site is obtained only when there is the assistance of the coenzyme or the cofactor. In this particular diagram, we can see the cofactor is helping and the coenzyme which is initially binding to the apoenzyme which is making the catalytic site active. That is, active site formation itself is assisted by the coenzyme and cofactor. That is how we can see the formation of the active site. Thus, for example, heme group in this particular diagram, we can see heme group is going to act as a coenzyme to make the enzyme very much functional. Okay, active site is nothing, it will be having two important sites. One is the binding site, also called as buttressing site, where the substrate actually binds. And one more site can be called as catalytic site, where exactly the function of the enzyme takes place and the conversion of the substrates into the products happens in that particular catalytic site. Let us see some more details of these coenzymes and also cofactors. As I already told, cofactors are the substances which can be organic or inorganic. Inorganic cofactors are usually the metallic ions which are assisting in the enzymatic activity. And organic cofactors will be of two types, that is coenzyme and also prosthetic group. Or coenzyme is one where the organic cofactor is not tightly bound to the apoenzyme or the actual enzymatic protein. Okay, here the cofactors can be once again they are assisting in the formation of the active site. In this diagram we can see cofactor is one such substance which is first coming and binding to the inactive apoenzyme. Apoenzyme will be in its inactive state when there is no cofactor. alone the apoenzyme cannot work here in case of conjugated enzymes. Without cofactor attached, the protein is very much inactive in the apoenzyme part, and it will get activated whenever there is binding of the cofactor. Cofactor binding is actually is an activator. Cofactor is an activator which is going to make the apoenzyme active. Then the substrates can come and bind to the these two active sites. The two substrates are capable of binding and converting into products. The actual catalysis takes place only after the addition of the cofactors to the apoenzyme. We can say inorganic cofactors are those which are required for the proper activity of the enzymes. These are usually the metallic ions. For example, enzyme carbonic anhydrase requires zinc Zn plus plus or zinc ions for its activity. At the same time, exokinase is active only when the cofactor magnesium ions are added to it. Some organic cofactors, that those are also very much helpful in activating the apoenzyme part of the conjugated enzymes. These are organic molecules required for the proper activity of the enzymes. Glycogen phosphorylase requires the small organic molecule, that is the pyridoxal phosphate. Pyridoxal phosphate is an organic cofactor which is helping in the activity of the enzyme. So we can take up types of specific coenzymes. Which are all the important types of these coenzymes based on the which particular group they are carrying along with it, and which is helping, assisting the apoenzyme to take up the carry of the particular group. Okay, these are usually organic compounds of complicated structure, often acting as carriers of some chemical group. Many coenzymes are either vitamins or derivative of the vitamins. Depending on the nature of the chemical group they carry, the coenzymes can be classified as follows. First one, hydrogen carriers. Hydrogen carriers are very much involved in the redox reactions, or EC1 enzyme group, that is oxidoreductases will get the assistance of these hydrogen carriers as the cofactors. Why we are calling it as coenzyme here? Because it is not tightly bound to the apoenzyme or actual protein part of the enzyme. Coenzyme 1, hydrogen carriers examples, coenzyme 1, which is also called as CO1 or NAD plus. Its reduced form is NADH plus H plus here. It contains the vitamin derivative, vitamin nicotinic acid, or also called as vitamin B3, niacin in amide form. So nicotinic acid is the chemical name of vitamin B3, niacin. So this particular vitamin derivative is going to help in the enzymatic activity. And next one is coenzyme 2 or CO2 or NADP plus. Its reduced form will be NADPH plus H plus. So lipoic acid is another example which helps in oxidative decarboxylation of keto acids. So one more important example is the ascorbic acid or vitamin C, and also some other redox reaction assisting coenzymes are FAD and FMN, that is flavin adenine dinucleotide and also flavin mononucleotides. Those are also very much important for EC1, that is oxidoreductase enzyme activity. Next one is acyl group carriers. Here the coenzyme A, which is popularly called as CoA, is one such coenzyme. It contains the substance that is phosphopantothenin, which is actually the derivative of the vitamin B5, that is pantothenic acid. Then comes the amino group carriers. pyridoxal phosphate is the derivative of the vitamin B6, that is pyridoxin, will be assisting in carrying the amino group and activating the enzyme's active site. And next coenzyme will be the carbon dioxide carriers. Which are all the carbon dioxide carriers? Usually the coenzyme R, these carbon dioxide carriers are called as coenzyme R popularly, and it is a derivative of the biotin and also the vitamin. This is the vitamin. Coenzyme R is a vitamin which often acts as a prosthetic group, not the coenzyme, but it is tightly bound to the coenzyme, so it is popularly the prosthetic group. And last one will be the thiamine pyrophosphate, which is also called as TPP, that is thiamine pyrophosphate, or cocarboxylase is another name for this particular coenzyme, which is a derivative of vitamin B1 or thiamine. It plays a very important role as coenzyme in the oxidative decarboxylation of keto acids. For example, pyruvic acid, alpha ketoglutaric acid will undergo decarboxylation reactions. So these are the five important coenzymes and prosthetic groups that will assist in the enzymatic activity. Next, the carrier of one carbon compounds. Those are one carbon compounds, as we all know, are the formic acid, formaldehyde, like that. For that, there is a coenzyme F, that is tetrahydrofolic acid. It is the derivative of vitamin folic acid, that is vitamin B9. So most of the vitamins are acting as the coenzymes. So as the vitamins are very much important, some of the water soluble and fat soluble vitamins, they are going to help in the enzymatic activity. So vitamin deficiency diseases are mainly because of the inactivation of most of the enzymes in our bloodstream. That's why the external diet should contain proper amounts of vitamins. Otherwise, the deficiency diseases are mainly because of the inactivation of these apoenzyme part of many enzymes. Then the ATP, that is adenosine triphosphate, is also a very important coenzyme and helps in catalyzing many enzyme reactions by activating either the substrate or the enzyme and providing energy. So it is also important co-substrate in most of the enzymes. So co-substrate and also the coenzyme it is. So it is going to help in providing energy to the substrate. It is also a carrier of the phosphate group. So ATP is one such important coenzyme helping in most of the biochemical reactions. Another one is uridine diphosphate, that is UDP, is a carrier of sugar molecules such as glucose, galactose are their derivatives. So this particular uridine diphosphate is also a very important coenzyme. Last one is PAPS, that is phosphoadenosine phosphosulfate. This is a carrier of sulfate group, which is a important coenzyme in acts as a carrier of sulfate group. So according to one more plant physiologist, that is Hom, he has given the important cofactors based on the utilization of the coenzyme, how exactly the nature of this organic substance will be that is helping in the catalytic activity. A coenzyme, which is nothing but a non-protein organic substance, which is dialyzable, able to pass through the semi-permeable membrane. What is dialyzable? Dialyzable is the capacity of this organic substance to pass through the membrane. here, it is very much dialyzable, so it is capable of being separated or removed by dialysis. And very importantly, they are thermostable and loosely attached to the protein part of the enzyme. These are nothing but the carrier molecules. So coenzymes are nothing but carrier molecules. They are not always bound tightly to the enzyme. So after conversion of the substrates to products, they'll be easily detached. They will come out of the cell since they are dialyzable substances. They can come out of the cell. A prosthetic group, according to whom the prosthetic group is an organic substance which is dialyzable and again thermostable, thermostable substance which is firmly attached to the protein. So these are the two definitions according to whom for the coenzyme and the prosthetic group. These cofactors, that is metallic ion activators, include potassium, ferrous, ferric, copper, cobalt, zinc, manganese, magnesium, copper, and also molybdenum ions. So one more important thing that we can discuss at this point is, whenever there is purification of protein or separation of different components of the protein, we use certain techniques like electrophoresis and also RAPD, RFLP, like that the amplified portions of the proteins and also the nucleic acids will be separated based on these techniques. At the same manner, this enzymatic protein can be separated using the electrophoretic technique, usually SDSPH, that is sodium dodecyl sulfate polyacrylamide gel electrophoresis, is used to separate the different molecular weight components of the enzymatic protein. All these separation of the protein and also purification of the enzyme in the crystalline form, everything has given us the enzymes are the globular tertiary proteins, which are very much important in the activity of the cell, since they are going to have the catalytic function which is going to enhance the biochemical reactions. Let's move on to the next one. Here we can see the enzymes are of two types. The chemical composition we saw, it is made out of the Apo enzyme, that is the protein part of the enzyme. Sometimes in conjugated proteins, Apo enzyme cannot take up the function, so it is going to take the assistance of the non-protein part, that is the cofactor. Apo enzyme mixed with cofactor, then only it will become holoenzyme, that will be the activated enzyme or functional enzyme. Here enzymes may function from where exactly the enzymes function, that is the site of action. Based on that, we can classify the enzymes into two important types, that is intracellular enzymes and extracellular enzymes. Intracellular enzymes are also retained and synthesized within the cell, and they are useful within the cell itself. They are found in the cytoplasm, nucleus, mitochondria, chloroplast, etc. And very good examples for the intracellular enzymes are oxidoreductases. They catalyze the biological oxidation, and also enzyme involved in the reduction in the mitochondria. All those enzymes are the intracellular or intrinsic enzymes. And other enzymes being extracellular enzymes, here most of the digestive enzymes can be called as extracellular enzymes, because they are going to act outside the cell, in the lumen of the cell. They will be seated and they will be helping in the catalytic activity. So extracellular enzymes are synthesized in the cell but secreted from the cell to the outside region, where actually they work. So they are called as the extracellular enzymes. Example being digestive enzymes. So this is the chemical composition of the enzyme. How exactly the chemical nature of the enzyme is? So enzyme is a three-dimensional protein which is tertiary globular proteins usually, and they are made out of two important parts, that is apoenzyme and the cofactor. Usually most of the enzymes are taking the help of the cofactor. Then only they become the complete enzyme, also called as holoenzyme. If there is no assistance, the only the protein part of the enzyme itself is going to take up the complete catalysis, then we call them as simple enzymes. Very good examples are the digestive enzymes like trypsin, pepsin, chemotrypsin, etc. And we can take up one more important inorganic cofactors, which are also assisting in the enzymatic activity. Those are simply called as the metallic ions or activators. Sometimes even inorganic ions are also tightly bound to the enzyme. They are called as prosthetic group. Organic prosthetic groups are also there, and inorganic prosthetic group is also there. Organic prosthetic group being pyridoxal phosphate, and inorganic prosthetic groups being the magnesium ions or potassium ions. Those are the inorganic prosthetic groups. And organic prosthetic groups, as I told, that is flavin mononucleotide or adenine triphosphate ATP, those are very important. They are tightly bound to the apoenzyme and they help in the catalytic activity. So this completes our chemical composition, how exactly the chemical nature of the enzymes will be. So in the next session, let us discuss which are all the properties of the enzymes. Let us see some of the references for this topic. Happy learning. See you.